Saturday basketball in the Big 12. Number 14, West Virginia on the road at 10-5 in the conference to take on Oklahoma State from Gallagher-Iba Arena. Jason Benetti, Reed Geddes along with you. You've heard about Press Virginia. Exactly how dedicated, Reed, are the Mountaineers to pressuring the opponents?
They are dedicated to the point that they press when you expect them to and when you don't expect them, as in off of missed free throws. But watch the commitment to not only trap the ball, but then once TCU breaks the pressure, now watch the heads turn of all these West Virginia players. They turn, look up the floor, and look at them sprint back inside the ball. More turnovers on the back end of the press. Totally committed to this style of basketball.
Well, Devin Williams is a guy who started the season with 5 straight double-doubles. A junior out of Cincinnati, and an 80-point-per-game offense for West Virginia that he helps lead. And a team that opening play today is one of the top 3 seed line teams in the NCAA tournament, one of the top 12 in Joe Lunardi's curve. And this is a game that they'd love to have to help keep them there as they head to Texas Tech and Baylor, their final 2 games, 1 at home and 1 on the road.
Well, for Mitchell Solomon and his teammates, the formula is not difficult to write on the board. You've got a rebound, you got to take care of the ball. Now doing it is a whole different deal.
The point guard is Tyree Griffin for Oklahoma State. Travis Ford says he's about 60% with a foot injury. This is a very dinged up Oklahoma State team. There's turnover number 1 forced by West Virginia. They get about 18 a game, second best in the country.
We expect to see a lot of 2-3 zone by Oklahoma State. They have not played much, if any, 2-3 zone. They've played a lot of 1-2-2 this year, but working really hard in practice in this 2-3 zone rotation out on the wings and down in the short corner.
Travis Ford today said he installed that 2-3 zone about 3 weeks ago as Javon Carter drives and a foul called on the rebounding action against Nathan Adrian, the hometown boy, the junior out of Morgantown.
Obviously, when you're going against West Virginia's press, you do not want to try to dribble through double teams. You want to commit the ball, get it back to the middle, and then pass the ball up the floor.
As we showed you earlier, they turn and run back, and they got back successfully that time.
You know, there's kind of this misconception that pressing teams force the most amount of turnovers with the ball in front of them. That's not true. Turnovers are created by hustling back inside the ball. Pursue and tip. That is what West Virginia does so well.
Why is that the case? Why are they so good at that?
Because they commit. We saw it in the open where everybody turns their head and sprints, and you sprint until you get inside the ball, and it's the defenders coming behind you that give you as much trouble as the two double teaming you.
Carter off the mark on the 3. West Virginia, not a great shooting team. 32% this year, 9th out of 10 in the Big 12 for Bob Huggins in his 9th season.
Bob Huggins' team number 2 in the country in offensive rebounding. A lot of times it almost feels as if their best offense is when they miss a shot. They get that ball up there on the rim and they rebound from all 5 positions.
So what are we going to watch tonight, Oklahoma State breaking this pressure?
Well, you've got to commit the ball to one side, reverse it, and eventually the ball's got to go down the middle of the court.
Tavares Schein bracketed, got it to Griffin. Near travel for Jeff Newberry. And West Virginia's got it with Tavon Myers, the junior out of Brooklyn.
Now, Oklahoma State needs to be equally committed to getting back into this zone defense. Turn and sprint till you get to your position.
Devin Williams takes advantage of the disorganized defense. And the Mountaineers on the board. Travis Ford, 5 of his 7 years at Oklahoma State before this one, into the NCAA tournament. It's a very down year.
Well, you saw him roll his eyes. Leighton Hammond, something happened to his hand. I don't know whether he cut. At first I thought he had blood, but it looks like he just jammed it and came off of the floor, and you saw Travis Ford's eyes just roll in the back of his head like, oh my gosh, at some point this cloud has got to leave us.
Lost a lot of players this season, and a big 3 knocked down by Oklahoma State's Schein.
Well, they got away with one. When you're running against a team that presses as well as West Virginia, never throw the ball down the midcourt stripe. If you throw that ball parallel to the stripe, you are just begging somebody to run through it.
Turnover by Issa Ahmad, the freshman for West Virginia. Joe Burton, the sophomore, has checked in for Oklahoma State. A pretty good three-point shooter.
Well, mismatch out here in the front. Nathan Adrian out here on Tyree Griffin.
Double comes. Burton gave up the three, and Mitchell Solomon finishes.
Nice fundamental play by Joe Burton. Caught that ball and turned and squared up and looked at the basket as soon as he caught it. And nice, easy basket for Mitchell Solomon.
Oklahoma State, one of the slowest pace teams, number of possession-wise, in the country. They will grind you out if you give them the chance. Devin Williams got hung up by Solomon, and Oklahoma State will run. Feed back to Newberry. Timeout, West Virginia.
A terrific start for Oklahoma State. They have done it outside, they've done it inside, they've done it in transition. And here's this pass that went all the way down the midcourt stripe. You see West Virginia almost ran through it and knocked down a three and then handled the pressure. Good, easy pass by Joe Burton. And right now, a lot of poise by Oklahoma State. And then when the opportunity presents itself, Oklahoma State, they want to play. They want this game down in the 60s. But if the opportunity presents themselves, these guys have got to run the floor and take advantage of numbers.
Oklahoma State 0-4 against ranked West Virginia. You look at the record for the Cowboys. You see it down at the bottom of your screen. 3-12 in the conference, 12-16 overall. You hear from locals about the timber around this program. You'd think they were 2-26 and coming off no NCAA tournaments. They've been to three straight.
Well, for Mitchell Solomon and Jeff Newberry, a lot of close games. 5 out of the 12 games have been decided by 5 points or less. So they have been competitive, just haven't finished.
Second line has come in for West Virginia. Jayshon Page, instant offense off the bench for the Mountaineers.
Oklahoma State's starters average 39 points per game. The four players off the bench for West Virginia average 44. 44 points per game on average off the bench for Bob Huggins.
Who has said our 10 are better than your 10?
Yeah, you know, a lot of people may say our starting five are better than yours, and he go, yeah, but let's go 10 to 10.
See what happens there. And a throwaway intended for Solomon from Hammonds.
Travis Ford will spend the entire evening begging, pleading with his kids, don't play too fast. Don't keep your poise and don't make them play a way we don't want to play.
And off this whistle, we will head to our first timeout. West Virginia trying to help itself, holding on to a tournament seed line, trailing by three.
I mean, I think Travis Ford's got to be ecstatic with the way his team has started. They've had a couple of unforced turnovers, but when they've maintained their poise and composure, Tyree Griffin and his teammates are off to a really good start in this game.
They are 3 out of 5 from the floor, though they have turned it over 3 times.
In the first meeting between these two teams, just 9 assists for the Cowboys to 16 turnovers.
Daxter Miles, the sophomore, cans the jumper and ties the game. Just a 28% three-point shooter, but he will hoist it. 103 attempts this year. Pressure on. Burton dribbles across midcourt for Oklahoma State.
Well, it is constant. I mean, it's 94 feet. They don't ever release you and take that pressure off of you.
Double team. Page pries it loose. Miles for Page, and he scores.
When you get double teamed, it is your teammates' responsibility to present themselves. You cannot leave a teammate stranded up there double teamed. You've got to flash to the middle of the floor.
Thrown away again. Miles out of bounds to Oklahoma State. Miles thinks he got fouled.
Well, watch Tyree Griffin get trapped down here on the other end. They're blitzing, double screening the ball, the rotation up, and then look, here comes Mitchell Solomon, but he's late. You've got to get there and be big and present yourself. stick your hands up, because realize your teammates who's in this double team is not going to have a lot of time to have a clean look.
Well, there was some discussion about who's going to get the ball. Rick Crawford accidentally pointed the wrong direction, and it will be Oklahoma State basketball. In the interim, while you were regaling us with your knowledge, Rick had pointed one direction toward West Virginia, and now back to Oklahoma State. Turnover on 33% of opponents' possessions. Yeah,
that's just crazy. They're pressing 36% of the time. Bob Huggins' team presses more than anybody in America this year. And people forget, this is a transformation for Bob Huggins. This is not the way his team's played over the years at Cincinnati. That's not how they played at K-State. And just amazing what he has built this program into. I have so much respect for what he has built in Morgantown.
Nearly a travel for Solomon. It looked like he left his feet. Got it off into the corner, and a beautiful find to Shine.
Shine's coming off of a good game against Oklahoma. Had 11 points, 5 rebounds. Very solid. Tavares Shine shooting over 30% out there behind the line.
That was his first career start, the loss against Oklahoma. And strong defense there by Shine on Page.
Yeah, they switched their defense from 2-3 to man-to-man. Looked like it caught West Virginia a little bit out of sync on their offensive end.
So let me ask you, what's the best way to beat West Virginia this year?
Yeah, you just got to handle the ball. You've got to make them beat you on the half court and beat you with jump shots, and then box out and don't give them second chance points.
Newberry was open and missed the three. West Virginia ball. It's easier said than done on the second chance
it's easy to write up on the board. I mean, they're number two in forced turnovers, number three in steals, and number two in offensive board. So there's your three things, and you say, we have to do these things well to have a chance to win this game.
Elijah Macon inside, got the bounce. It's not an overwhelmingly big team either. Macon 6'9", one of their taller players, but they really get after it on the board.
Well, they just keep coming at you. And we talked about the depth. And so every time there's a media timeout, there's four fresh bodies out there. And for a team that's lacking in depth like Oklahoma State is, boy, it can really wear on you as the second half comes around.
Newberry wanted to feed the post. And Chris Olivier, the grad student. Whoa. Let's tell you about an NBA game not far from here. Warriors Thunder, 8:30 ABC NBA Saturday primetime. Steph Curry and the Splash Brothers to battle Kevin Durant, Russell Westbrook, easy for me to say, in Oklahoma City. Streaming live on Watch ESPN and the ESPN app, presented by La Quinta. You were trying to score us tickets for that
in the
second half.
Yes, I was. And I haven't given up yet.
Yeah, that's
so
good.
Hang in there.
I like your fortitude. What a game that's going to be. And a foul against Shine up top.
Well, that's what Oklahoma State can't do. They are so shallow. There are so few guys to substitute in for Travis Ford. You can't take a silly foul if you're Tavares Shine. And Travis is saying, come on, be smart. Don't just stick your hand up on somebody 24 feet from the basket. Now, we talked about those 44 points averaged off of the bench for West Virginia. So far, 9 of their 11 points have come from bench players.
There's that pressure off a miss. And another throwaway. That's turnover number 7 in just over 7 minutes.
Yeah, but just silly mistakes. And that's what you can't do against anybody, much less West Virginia. There was no pressure there. Just threw it out of bounds. Second time that Oklahoma State has been down there, they broke the press and then just slung it out of bounds.
Yeah, a couple Oklahoma State coaches said earlier, whether it was tongue-in-cheek or not, they were hoping for 12 or fewer turnovers in this game.
Well, I would think that would be very optimistic.
Miles, quick pass, and Page shut off. Pretty active defense for Oklahoma State.
Yeah, matching up right now in the 2-3. A lot of communication, people pointing.
Miles, long jumper.
Good hustle.
nicely saved, and Miles got clothesline and a kick ball against Burton.
Yeah, really good hustle. I don't know if Tyree Griffin is hurt or not, but he came from the opposite side guard position, almost outside the three-point line, and ran a rebound down in the far corner outside the three-point line. Great effort.
You know, Travis Ford said earlier that Tyree Griffin just about once a game right now tweaks that ankle. That's about 60%.
Man, he's been playing really good, and I don't know what percentage he is, but last three games, assist to turnover ratio up there at Monty Morris level, about 5-1.
Five turnovers in the last three games compared to 24 assists. Burton on the attack after they break the press and didn't get the roll. Tariq Phillip thought about the three, instead found an open man. Bodies everywhere on the rebounding action.
I looked down at Bob Huggins to see if he was happy with that shot. Jonathan Holton did not hesitate, has only made 9 3-pointers all season long. Not sure that's the shot Coach Huggins wants. You know, see, nobody's coming to him. He's getting in trouble. He's picking up his dribble, and everybody's standing and looking at him, and you got to flash to an open spot.
Holton the rebound. Into the post, Devin Williams. No, and Holton got a hand on it. Timeout. Oklahoma State, West Virginia has scored the last four to lead by three on the road. Vince, thank you. We wish you the best in the studio, and we offer you the best spray tan in America here in Stillwater.
Hey, dude, do you think I look orange after this tan?
Uh-huh.
No, I don't think so. It looks good. It looks natural.
You know, sometimes when you eat certain snacks, you get a little on your fingers.
Yeah.
Got a little excessive there.
You know, listen to studio guys talk about that big win by Vanderbilt. Remember, it's that time of the year where wins have ripple effects. And one of those is, remember, the early in the year in the Big 12, Baylor just manhandled Vanderbilt in Waco. And so, well, that's a huge win for Kevin Stallings and that team, and they needed one bad.
Makes that win by Baylor look even better.
Yeah, it does.
For a Big 12 that has right now the second best RPI for a conference since the year 2000.
It has been, for the second year in a row, the number one RPI and the highest in league history. And man, that's going back a long time. 15 years since this conference. Bob Huggins is the newest member of the league along with TCU, but boy, it is amazing night in and night out. You know, no further example than look down to Austin earlier today in the game before us. When Oklahoma goes into Austin, and Texas at the end of the game goes on a 22-0 run after the Sooners were up by 7.
Oklahoma hits 10 threes in that game, still loses. West Virginia all over the boards with Devin Williams. Mountaineers just 2 for their last 8 from the floor, but leading by 3 on the road the first 10 minutes. Williams was right next to Adrian, scored it anyway, and a foul.
Yeah, credit that basket to Nathan Adrian. Nathan Adrian steps into Olivier, screens him off, and look at the passing angle right there. Look at Nathan, he's backing up. Boy, he's taking X5, the defensive player in the middle of the zone, Olivier, and not only sealed him off, but he backed him completely out of in front of the basket, and an easy basket for Bob Huggins, big man inside.
Williams has taken 172 free throws this year, by far the most on the West Virginia roster, a 68% shooter who has 5 of the 16.
If you're a West Virginia fan, you're already aware of it, but Devin Williams started this season with 5 consecutive double-doubles. That's the first time in almost 50 years anybody at West Virginia has done that.
Now Oklahoma State down to 2 timeouts. As we look at the Big 12 bracketology, Oklahoma has dropped off the 1 seed line, according to Joe Lunardi, with that loss to Texas. West Virginia holding firm in the three position, and this all pending the Big 12 championship in Kansas City. Oh, by the way, guess what Kansas did today? A 12th straight at least share of the Big 12 title.
It almost defies description what Phil Self has done in Lawrence, Kansas, and that big win. Nice to see them celebrate. They cut down the nets and celebrated with the trophy, as well they should have. And Bob Huggins, one of 70% of the league's teams currently projected to be in the NCAA tournament.
Isn't that amazing what the league has done?
Simply amazing. Look at this. When you talk about the Mount Rushmore of college basketball coaches, why in the world isn't Bill Self front and center on your selection of four? Look at those numbers compared to the peers that normally you would say, oh, if you have a Mount Rushmore, well, Coach K's on it, and Jim Boeheim and all those guys. And, boy, that was a telling statistic right there.
Well, if you had titled that table Hall of Fame Coaches, you very easily could have convinced somebody that that was the case. And another turnover for Oklahoma State against this pressure.
If you dribble across half court and pick up the ball, what you've done is you've allowed four players to trap you, and that's what Travis Ford is saying. So you've got two defensive players, you've got the midcourt stripe, and you've got the sideline. And you know what? The midcourt stripe and the sideline, they never screw up. They're always right where they're supposed to be.
Very consistent, normally.
You dribble across, look, pick it up right there, and boy, you're just stuck. There's just nowhere to go.
Second chance there for Williams. And the rebound snatched away by Solomon for Oklahoma State, and he's trying to find a teammate. How about the recovery by Page all over Newberry? And an open look for three. Shine once again, the beneficiary, his third triple.
That is his spot on the floor. And so right now, Oklahoma State, that has been their answer to the pressure. If they can break in and give Tavares Shine a clean look in that corner, they're pulling the trigger regardless of how much time's on the shot clock.
With all the injuries, he's come on strong late in the year. Three of his last four games in double figures. Six to shoot for Page and the Mountaineers. Into the post for Williams. One and done for the Mountaineers. Griffin breaks the press and got it away for Burton for two. Quick five in a row for the Cowboys. Boy, that's a hot pass to handle into the post.
Really hard pass to handle. Go back and let's look at that graphic again about coaches. And Coach K won five titles and five for Cal and Coach Williams. And you look at those numbers, and then you multiply it by a factor of two, of three, of four, and you get into the conversation of where Bill Self finds himself today, trailing only UCLA, who has 13 consecutive titles. Remarkable.
You would think, too, if there's any year, it might have been this year with the way West Virginia's been playing. But Shine buries another three. A career-high four threes in the first 12 minutes for Tavares Shine.
If you're West Virginia, you're going to suddenly have to make an adjustment and find Shine, but he is absolutely on fire right now.
That's a travel against Carter for West Virginia.
Well, Oklahoma State got in a hole, and Tavares Shine has shot them back into this game. And he's kissing three-pointers all over the floor.
Two-point lead for Oklahoma State, thanks in large part to a sophomore by the name of Tavares Shine, Reed.
Now look at him spot up down here at the bottom of your screen. Look, he's just licking his chops. He wiped his hands off like a gunfighter, getting them dry. And boy, three shots buried from the exact same spot on the floor. And then the last one was up top. But right now, that is how Oklahoma State is breaking this pressure. They are breaking down, and Tavares Shine's not flashing to the ball. He is finding open spots and staying stationary and counting on teammates to find him. Already a career high in three-point field goals made.
He's really improved as a shooter the last couple of weeks. Five straight games with at least two threes, culminating in this very powerful shooting first half. Griffin had it tipped. got it across midcourt anyway to Newberry, the lone senior starting for this team.
Well, look how hard it is to run your offense. I mean, West Virginia denies every pass. They're blitzing, double-teaming on the ball screens. Just relentless.
Great recovery there on Solomon.
I swear, sometimes you look out there and you think there's seven guys in blue shirts.
Solomon buries the three, his third of the year.
He knocked down that shot, and Jonathan Holton turned around and looked over at Coach Huggins, and Huggins just kind of leaned back and put his palms up like, we'll take that one.
Well, it's not going to be on the scouting report, and we're going the other way. A whistle against West Virginia.
Now Solomon comes into the game 2 for 15 for the season, catches this, and pretty good defense. You see Nathan Adrian's out there and put his hands on him, and after he hit it, he looked over at Coach Huggins and was like, okay, you're going to have to beat us with that shot.
5 of 8 from three-point range for a 34% three-point shooting team. And after the basket interference, a travel at the end line. Griffin unable to run the baseline because that wasn't a made field goal. Turnover number 9.
Yeah, Tyree Griffin did not understand that. He's still looking at the official saying, no, the basket counted, and it's exactly right. That's stationary, and you have to have a pivot foot.
Elijah Macon, the sophomore. Big-to-big passing, extra feed down low, and it'll stay with West Virginia. Adrian had it knocked out of his hands. Next Big Monday presented by Delta, start of the ACC, 7 Eastern. Syracuse on the bubble, got a win today. He'll take on number 7 North Carolina. Then in the Big 12, number 2 Kansas at number 25 Texas with that big win, 9 Eastern. It is Big Monday on ESPN presented by Delta, also available on Watch ESPN and in the ESPN app.
Mitchell Solomon just got called for a foul using his leg to try to dislodge the post player. And those are the kind of fouls that could really come back and haunt you in the second half.
Especially with the lack of depth, as you see Kansas once again, 12 straight season with at least a share of the title. Texas, after that early loss to TCU, now at 10-6 in the Big 12 behind Shaka Smart. Another open look for 3, and this time Joe Burton rings it up.
Something about that left corner over there in the court, and well, the Cowboys are absolutely killing them from that corner.
14-0 run for Oklahoma State, which has lost 6 of 7 coming in. Miles on the back cut will go to the free throw line, where he's a 61% shooter. That's the second on Solomon, so you're just talking about it. You pick up the maybe rinky-dink foul a couple possessions ago. Here's your second personal.
Yeah, and then suddenly here's Olivier coming in for you, and a tough decision for Travis Ford, and will not play Mr. Solomon the remaining 5 minutes and 51 seconds. But you're right, the foul he just took is the one he needs to take, and that's a ball being dribbled at you and being a, you know, physical play. The other one is one that'll come back and really haunt you.
Free throw no good for Miles. And Oklahoma State, we've talked about the injuries. Phil Forte with the UCL injury. If you're a baseball fan, it's like Tommy John surgery that he would have if it was a complete tear of the UCL. He's on the bench. Juwan Evans, maybe the freshman of the year in the league, injured with a shoulder problem after a pass a couple of weeks ago. And so they're really down. You're talking about 9 guys, 8.5, really.
You talked to Travis Ford, and he tells you, I've had to coach 3 teams. So we lost all of our starters, lost 3 from last year. We build the team around Phil Forte. He goes out. Then I build around my freshman, Juwan Evans, and he goes out. And so this is the 3rd time we've had to completely change our approach to the game.
You saw Evans in that shoulder sling. 3 games of Forte, 13 points a game. Evans, 5 assists a game. They're out. What do you do? I mean, that's a big part of your team.
Well, and it's a little misleading because Evans, the last 6 games that Phil Forte was on the bench, he saw his teammate, Juwan Evans, he was averaging 20 points, 6 rebounds, and 6 assists. Very much had put this team on his back.
A strange injury. He was making a pass into the post from the top of the key and had a cartilage issue pop in his shoulder. It's a foul against Adrian, his 2nd personal.
West Virginia played excellent defense for about 27 seconds, and Oklahoma State struggling just to initiate their offense, and then a silly foul perhaps by Nathan Adrian. But it's just so relentless, Jason. I mean, it's just relentless, and it doesn't matter whether they make shots, miss shots, doesn't matter. It's just constantly on you.
Miles to Page that time. Turnover number 10 leads to two free throws for the Mountaineers. Look, you played point guard at a high level. Playing point guard yourself, how do you work against this pressure?
It's not all on you. And if you play West Virginia and you try to treat this like it's all on me and I've got to handle the pressure and I've got to break the pressure, if you do that, Daxter Miles and the rest of these guards, they will eat you alive. And so you've got to keep your head up. You've got to be willing to do a pullback dribble, a retreat dribble. When the double team comes at you, draw the double team back and then rely and trust on your teammates to flash to open spots and not stay in one spot.
So it's about movement without the ball.
Yeah, absolutely. But if you think this is mano-a-mano and I'm going to handle this pressure and I'm going to dribble through it, they will eat you alive.
Two for two for Tariq Phillip, the junior out of Brooklyn. Griffin up ahead to Jeffrey Carroll, who's back in. He's been dealing with a stomach bug the last 3 weeks and didn't play in the loss against Oklahoma on Wednesday.
Yeah, really strange illness. You know, they say he wakes up some days and can't get out of bed and woke up today and said, hey, I feel great. Now, Rico Gathers at Baylor's dealing with something very similar.
Griffin splits two. Didn't get the bounce. Doubt Carroll's going to become an NFL tight end, though, like Rico. Page bumping in the lane for two. 14 points a game off the bench for West Virginia, and Page draws the Mountaineers within three.
Coming off a game against Iowa State in which he had 34 points, a new West Virginia record for a non-starter, points off the bench.
First game went to the Mountaineers 77-60 back in January. Much different tonight. Carroll slicing and got fouled as we hit the under four timeout in Stillwater. Oklahoma State giving the Mountaineers quite the game, leading by three.
Look, 12 titles in a row in any conference would be absolutely amazing. But in a conference as good as the Big 12, you're talking about you're suddenly in John Wooden's neighborhood, and that's pretty rarefied air, partner.
They're going to start talking about ACC bias because Corey Alexander's down there in ACC country, the former Cavalier himself now. It's going to be interesting to see in March, though, if the Big 12 can have that big year in the tournament.
There's no question about that. And the last several years have been disappointing in the NCAA tournament. And so that is a very valid point that this is a good time for a Big 12 team or two or three of them to make a deep run.
Oklahoma State has really struggled with the turnover already today. 11 for the Cowboys.
But surprisingly, 9 assists on 9 made field goals. So when they've not turned it over, they've been able to make a pass that's led to a basket.
Miles from the corner. And Williams out-dueled for the rebound by Newberry at 5'11".
Well, Olivier posted up, really frustrated. He's not getting the ball down inside. Got him over there on the right block calling for it.
And once again, Oklahoma State finds its way to the rim. 4 for Burton.
Well, amazing. Cowboys are up by 5, and they've turned the ball over 11 times in the first half.
Whistle down low against West Virginia.
Yeah, that's on Jonathan Holton. And he went in. We saw Nathan Adrian seal the middle of that zone by turning around and posting up. That time, Holton didn't turn around and use his backside. He used his front side, so it looked like just a lead blocker going into the hole before the running back.
The Again, just two timeouts remaining for Oklahoma State after calling one on pressure and one to stop a run. Carroll, Burton, long step into the lane, and he went over the back. Foul against Joe Burton of the Cowboys. Tonight, after Florida LSU, SportsCenter at night, Steve Levy, Nicole Briscoe, all the highlights from college basketball, the NBA, including that Warriors-Thunder game on ABC with some updates there, latest from spring training, and the NFL Combine in Indianapolis. On-field workouts for the quarterbacks today, SportsCenter at night, after College Hoops, right here on ESPN, streaming live on Watch ESPN. Williams, the first free throw. Devin Williams out of Montverde Academy, where he spent a season. 12 double-doubles. You mentioned it, five to start the year.
Now 29 in his career, trails only Rico Gathers for career double-doubles. And well, he is a full-grown man, and he has blossomed into quite a player.
Burton, with his eyes up, looking at the rim, decided to take it back out. We've seen Oklahoma State be very aggressive in that situation so far tonight. Burton on the dive, one dribble for two.
Let me tell you who gets credit for that basket, and that's Olivier. He's down there working really hard, posting up. Chris Olivier had Devin Williams trying to front him and fight him, opened up the lane for the back cut down the middle.
Tariq Phillip missed the floater. Williams kept it alive. Blue shirts everywhere. Williams palms it in.
He is just such a load that it's hard to put your body into it. And when you do it, you gotta back him up. You can't just stand straight.
So Oklahoma State with 11 turnovers, but a three-point lead in the first half against number 14, West Virginia.
Well, Olivier wants that ball. They're just not gonna give it to him.
Burton, an errant shot for three, and a whistle up high.
Jason, here's that last play. Look at Olivier posting up at the top of your screen, and that's what opens up the post. He's fighting, so Devin Williams is trying to front him. That removes all of the defense out of the middle of the lane and opens up a backcourt, and Chris Olivier working really hard down in the paint, and not getting a lot of tangible results, but he's doing his job.
Well, Anthony Allen's checked in for Oklahoma State, and that's because of a second foul against Burton as well. Olivier will get a breather. Well,
everybody's got two or three fouls right now for Oklahoma State.
West Virginia is a really interesting case study with all the fouls that it creates. Gets to the free throw line, fourth most of any team in the country, 791 attempts coming into this game, but only 288 free throw percentage-wise, and a foul going against Tariq Phillip. That's his second for West Virginia.
Well, coming into this game in Big 12 conference games, West Virginia ninth in the conference in free throw percentage, and Bob Huggins is frustrated right now. Tyree Griffin drew that foul. He ran right into Tariq Phillip, and Tariq Phillip had his hands up, and Tyree Griffin just kept going straight into him and forced the officials to make that call. And Bob Huggins is really frustrated. He's over here saying, look, his hands are up straight, and that's no different than an offensive player jumping into a defensive player. Only difference was he didn't have the ball.
Bob Huggins was just told by our officiating crew to settle down, and if you're a lip reader,
he's disagreeing.
He's not happy. Free throw for Griffin on the front end, no good. So West Virginia can take the lead on this possession. Page off the screen for Williams.
The 2-3 zone's been pretty good for Oklahoma State.
Put the shoulder in and faded away from Burton. Neatly done by Page.
Boy, that was about as effortless of a step back as you'll see. Jayshon Page got down to the short corner and just gradually stepped back.
Another turnover for Oklahoma State. And a foul called. Holton battling near the rim.
Here's the foul that got Bob Huggins so upset. Look at Tariq Phillips. He's backing up and he's got his arms out. And Tyree Griffin at any point could have cut back the other way. And that's what Phillip is saying. That's what Huggins is saying. He's saying, look, his arms are up and you can't just keep running into the defensive player. That's that sphere, that cone of protection that has been emphasized all year long, that not only does the offensive player get that cylinder, but so does the defensive player.
You try and keep yourself in the cone of protection.
Yeah, the cone of silence is the best place for me.
Holton, the 70% foul shooter, and a whistle on the rebounding action going the other way.
It's going to be on Devin Williams going over the back of Anthony Allen, and Allen will go to the free throw line, I believe, a 53% shooter for the season.
And we'll get a look, too, at Igor Ibaka, who doesn't play a whole bunch for Oklahoma State. The younger brother of Serge Ibaka of the Thunder comes in as Williams called for the foul. Allen just 1 point the last eight games for Oklahoma State. Got the first.
Well, two times this year Anthony Allen has blocked six shots in a game, and now that is his role for Oklahoma State. He needs to be a rim protector, and Anthony Allen's going to have a big role in this game in the second half with all of the fouls mounting up for the Cowboys.
Ibaka cleared out by Holton for the Williams rebound. And you mentioned the foul trouble. Three against Burton, two on Shine, two on Solomon, two on Hammonds. Miles the pitch for Williams. Offensive rebound, West Virginia so good at that. Carter. And Oklahoma State can hold to the last shot.
West Virginia needs to do a better job with second chance points.
That's a wild pass by Newberry. Miles leaning in. Holton was there for the follow. That wouldn't drop. Carter plucks it and fires for three. What a turnaround on that possession for the Mountaineers at the end of the half.
They just play so hard and they are so relentless, and boy, nothing pretty about this possession, but look at the effort by West Virginia. Carter knocking down a three for a little bit of momentum going into the locker room, and man, just a tenacious effort in that last sequence.
33-29. West Virginia created 13 first half turnovers. Now for the ESPNU halftime report, Brendan Fitzgerald is your navigator. Eddie Reed Geddes along with you. Look, this unending, relentless press for West Virginia has caused some turnovers, but the offense has been there for Oklahoma State.
You know, a really strange half of basketball. I'm not sure I ever remember a game in which each possession ended in either a turnover, there were 13 turnovers, or a made basket. There were 10 assists on 11 made field goals, and for Oklahoma State, they had some really ugly possessions and some really bad passing, but when they handled the ball, boy, their three-point shooting was outstanding. 6 for 10. Tavares Shine was outstanding. Solomon hit one, a lot of people. Joe Burton knocked down a three. And so when they handled the pressure, boy, the next pass usually led to a basket.
Your wheelhouse is the point guard position, and you've been worn down by pressure in the past. How much does it affect a team more in the second half than the first half?
You know, the problem when it's so relentless is it'll go in spurts. So you'll handle it well for two or three possessions, and then all of a sudden you'll look up and the pressure gets to you and you have a turnover and a second turnover and a third turnover. And so that's what Oklahoma State needs to avoid. It's not realistic to say, don't turn it over in the second half. And so if you're Travis Ford, you're saying, don't let them go on a run. Don't let one turnover turn into two, three, four turnovers in a row.
Foul trouble also important for Oklahoma State. Four players with at least two personals, including Joe Burton with three in that first half. The drive from Jayshon Page, who starts the second half after coming off the bench in the first half, and a second chance for West Virginia, the 10th offensive rebound for the Mountaineers. Tavon Myers walked.
Yeah, he is really struggling. That ball is sticking in his hands, and he's not swinging it, and really indecisive out of here on the point for Myers.
Page decides to fire.
Yeah, really out of sync. You know, twice that post guy was signaling for a cutter to come off of him, running this flex set with a back screen, down screen, and the flex cut was never coming. And, well, a little bit of frustration by West Virginia that first offensive possession.
It's the second foul on Page. Is that just miscommunication? Yeah. Guys on different pages?
You know, I don't know. I don't know who was right. I don't know whether the play was supposed to come off of him or not. But for Bob Huggins, it's frustrating because clearly they're not on the same page. You know, I don't know who was wrong, but not a very good first possession. And especially coming out of the locker room, you'd think, man, we've talked about it. Here's what we're going to emphasize. And not so much there that first possession.
West Virginia providing that constant pressure. Solomon in the lane, had it knocked away. Myers off the hit ahead, and he got jammed on. Two free throws coming for Tavon Myers.
It was a physical game, and you see from behind, Tyree Griffin almost came and got that ball. Good, tough play. Nothing wrong with that play. That is all three guys making a basketball play.
That's good news, too, for Oklahoma State, that it's Griffin and his first rather than Shine and his third.
You know, interesting statistic from the first half. West Virginia had half as many turnovers as Oklahoma State, yet Oklahoma State had more points off of turnovers than West Virginia did.
What do you make of that?
Well, I don't know. You know, a lot of missed shots for West Virginia, but, well, you turn somebody over 13 times, Bob Huggins would like to see more points off of turnovers than just the 11 he got in the first half.
He was telling us earlier today, sometimes he feels like his team is only going to score a guaranteed bucket on a fast break if it's one on none.
Well, that's a little Huggins-esque. Now their numbers have exceeded expectations all season long. Bob Huggins' team and Tavon Myers, they were picked in preseason polls sixth, and they have been in the top three and ranked as high as number six in the country, and perhaps more than any team in the Big 12 this year have exceeded all reasonable expectations for this team.
It's a question about where the clock should be, so that's what the officials are talking over. Yeah, clock didn't start, as you can see, off the contact with the basketball, so they will time it and see how much should come off the clock. Talk about Bob Huggins, is what he's done in his coaching career into the postseason. 29 of his 33 years, going to be 30 out of 34 with this season, as you'll get a look at what the officials are watching on the monitor.
Well, 27 times he's won over 20 games, including this season at 21-7, two Final Fours, four Elite Eights, six times Coach of the Year. And I guess, Jason, one of the things that impresses me the most about coaches who have coached as long as Bob Huggins, and there aren't many in the country that have done it, but the fact that he's remade, not himself, but he's remade his team, and he's adapted to the type and the skill set that he's recruiting, and it's been amazing the way they play and they've bought into it. And listen, every kid you recruit says, yeah, coach, I want to run. I want to run, I want to press, I want to play up tempo. You know what? It's really hard to run and play up tempo the way West Virginia does. It takes an enormous commitment, not only mental toughness, but physical toughness, and you got to have depth to do it. But you have got to really buy in to play the style of basketball that these kids play.
They're going to knock 4 seconds off the clock here. You're talking about doing it for 40 minutes.
For 40 minutes
every
all
night.
Over the court. Made shots, missed shots, off rebounds, off of jump ball. I mean, the jump opening tip, they'll double team you after the tip. And it just takes a commitment. And the biggest thing, and we've talked about it the entire game, is the commitment to hustle back inside the ball. Once the offense breaks the pressure, you have got to sprint back to the level of the ball.
Well, Carter is just stapled to Newberry, forced him to give up the ball. Double comes again. Hammond's on the drive and kick. We talk about the pace and the pressure. Fair comparison, those Nolan Richardson Arkansas teams?
Yeah, I think that's fair. I don't know that West Virginia is as good as those teams were offensively, but certainly as relentless on the defensive end.
Adrian for two.
Reminds me some of Eddie Sutton's teams at Arkansas and the triplets and the way they kept pressure on you the entire basketball game.
Griffin the dish. Shine wanted his fifth three. And Newberry the rebound. Just the second offensive rebound for Oklahoma State. Solomon bottled up. Griffin, fadeaway, yes. A lot of contact on that possession.
And Tyree Griffin's wincing. He came off, he bumped into Devin Williams and he backed off and his face was all scrunched up. And I guess it's that ankle, but he's still done. Maybe his eye. He may have gotten hit in the eye.
Jay Sean Page, the leading scorer for West Virginia. Here is Page triggering for three. Devin Williams got hogtied and fouled.
Here's that play on the other end. Tyree Griffin, watch him run into Devin Williams and bump him, and then he steps back after the contact. And I can't tell. I don't know. But, boy, his whole face scrunched up as he came down the court. And he doesn't look like he's limping, so maybe he just got poked in the eye a little bit.
Jeffrey Carroll checks in for Oklahoma State. Shine is out. That was his third personal. So Tavares Shine, who had 12 in the first half, will take a seat.
As soon as Jeffrey Carroll checked in, Travis Ford said, hey, JC, they're going to try to post you. Be strong down there.
Tavon Myers cans at three, just his ninth of the year in West Virginia, getting some balanced scoring today. Nine players in the scorebook for Bob Huggins. Griffin maneuvers well and threw it right to Williams. Big bump on Page. And a whistle on the floor, it looks like.
Look, great hands by Devin Williams. A fast break. Tyree Griffin coming right at him. He feinted at him. He jabbed at him, baited the pass, and stuck that big right hand out and stole it. And that was a terrific defensive play by your big man with a 5'10 point guard with a full head of steam coming right at you. Not sure that dude gets enough credit in this league. Devin Williams
does a lot,
oh,
doesn't he?
Oh my gosh.
A lot of different categories.
Yeah, he does.
Making the sophomore in into the post for West Virginia. Page, the floater, and making the rebound. 13 offensive rebounds for West Virginia. At 18 in the first meeting. Page, nifty move.
Well, that was strong. You know, Jayshon Page takes off dribbling a lot with his left hand out in front of him. Almost looks like a running back with a stiff arm, and he doesn't have that arm bent. He's got it straight out in front of him.
Don't kind of like Maurice Jones-Drew. Jayshon Page has West Virginia an 11-point lead on the road. Behind Iowa State by one in the loss column after the defeat earlier, and who knows what's going to happen, but Iowa State has been the team to beat in this championship the last couple years.
You know, the tough question for Steve Prohm, look, nobody get mad at me, because you want to win the Big 12 championship. You want to go and win this tournament, but if you're only playing with six or seven guys as opposed to Bob Huggins, who goes 10 deep, do you really want to expend the energy to go win three games? The energy it will take to win that tournament this year and the back-to-back-to-back games, well, you're going to expend a lot of energy if you only got six players.
Tyree Griffin was out of bounds, came back in, touched the ball, and it will be West Virginia basketball as Travis Ford examines the palm of his hand. I mean, that was a heck of a press break for Griffin. Did it all himself and came inbounds off the miss. Page knifing through for two more. You're saying Iowa State, this is a team that maybe with the depth, you just go into the NCAA tournament and you roll the dice?
Yeah, I mean, you're not going to roll over and not try. But if you were to lose that first game, I'd say, doggone, we lost it. Let's take 2 days off. Let's get well, have some practice time. Bob Huggins, on the other hand, the way they play and the number of players they rotate in, well, they are custom built to go win three tough games in 3 days.
And you look right now, the three seed is the projection. Say you go and win the Big 12 championship while winning this game, and then Texas Tech and add Baylor to close the regular season. This team could be vying for a two seed, maybe one of the top two seeds in the bracket.
You know, it's kind of like when you play a team that runs the spread offense in football or air raid, or suddenly you see the triple option. When you play Bob Huggins' team for the first time, when you don't have the history of what it feels like to go, it's hard to simulate that in practice and to get ready for them. And that's why West Virginia is such a dangerous team in March.
Solomon, two and a foul, off the fine from Burton.
You know, one of the few times that we have seen Oklahoma State take the ball and go all the way to the basket, they have only attempted three free throws in this game. And we've seen the entire first half when they broke the press, Joe Burton or Tavares Shine spotted up in the corner shooting threes, that time going inside to Mitchell Solomon.
You know, if you're watching and you're a Cowboys fan or you just memorize numbers, Solomon was number 41 at the beginning of this game. His jersey was torn, so now he is the unnamed Mr. 55 for the Cowboys. Sophomore out of Bixby, Oklahoma, a mechanical engineering major.
Yeah, the defensive adjustment by Travis Ford. They're going to a half-court trap. 1-3-1.
Had the turnover, lost the turnover. Miles kick into the corner. Got it back. And a whistle, three seconds.
Yeah, Jonathan Holden standing down there in the lane and didn't even know it. It goes against conventional wisdom, but a lot of coaches will tell you, press a pressing team. Look at Holden, he's down there in the lane. And yeah, absolutely. He's just staying in there and never got out. It's a good call.
Never-ending pressure for West Virginia. Griffin makes his way through it, fighting off an ankle injury. Leighton Hammonds off the mark. Rebound Page into the fray. Solomon got rid of it out to Griffin.
Well, that's the last thing you want to do if you're Jayshon Page, is jump out of bounds underneath the basket you're defending and roll the ball back out in front of the rim. Just eat that thing, go out of bounds, and set up your defense.
The size of Holden on the 5'10 Griffin. Nice switches back with Page, 10 to shoot. Burton got the three.
Tyree Griffin with a great penetrated pitch. Going back to that 1-3-1, going to try to trap the ball as soon as it crosses half court.
If anybody wanted a backcourt violation, you've got a clear midcourt.
Rule of three, both feet and the ball.
Macon was calling for the ball on the skip. Page takes it himself over two defenders.
My. That ball went up over the shot clock with Arch. What a tough, tough basket by Jayshon Page.
Well, you were talking about it before the game. They elevated the roof in this arena, and might have been a good idea considering that shot. Ooh, a foul against West Virginia after Hammonds extended the arm.
Watch how high this ball goes, Arch. The step back over a double team, and boy, that's beautiful. He does that so effortless. You know, you see a lot of guys that when they step back, they're really, you know, really fighting and pushing hard. And Jayshon Page sticks that right foot into the wood court and pushes back. Just, man, so smooth and easy.
Second year in the program for Page. Out of Jamestown, New York, the home of Lucille Ball.
Well, there you go. I did not know that.
It's always a take home. Murray drive. Wouldn't fall for Burton.
Ooh, Griffin may be hurt. He came down hard.
The ball hit him while he was out of bounds. West Virginia basketball.
Well, there was a lot of contact. Here's that half-court trap by Oklahoma State again.
Little hesitation, and Macon cycles it back out for Miles.
Yeah, but they're not getting hurt on the back end, so I would assume that Travis Ford will stay in this 1-3-1 trap, because even when West Virginia breaks it, they're not taking it all the way through to the basket.
That's the fourth foul against Joe Burton as we hit the timeout, and coming back, Reed Geddes and I have some hardware to hand out. Big 12 postseason awards. We'll send you your own if you stay with us. We agree on three of them.
Easiest this voting has ever been. So let me make it more difficult. Who's your backup player of the year? Who's your runner-up?
Backup player of the year. Oh, my gosh. That's really difficult.
Perry Ellis?
See, that's where I was going to go.
George Niang?
Yeah, I would say George Niang.
Yeah. I'm going to go with Perry Ellis. How about your runner-up newcomer?
Well, could we do coach of the year?
No, that's too hard.
We're not going to do that.
The three we agreed on were really. Boy, that fourth one is. I think every Saturday, my opinion. Ellis, how about your runner-up newcomer?
Well, could we do coach of the year?
No, that's too hard.
We're not going to do that.
The three we agreed on were really easy. Boy, that fourth one is. I think every Saturday, my opinion of coach of the year changed.
Yep.
And it even changed today.
We did. It really?
It changed today. I changed my vote and I didn't tell you.
Well, that's not fair.
Oh, no, it's fair. I can make the rules.
Great. You make your own rules.
But that was the hardest. I mean, it was unbelievable how difficult it is to really come up with. It's easy to come up with a candidate. It's hard to distinguish between the others. So let's see. Who'd you pick?
Blocking foul. Hammond's the bucket. All right. My coach of the year. I think it's fairly easy. He's won. Well, Tubby Smith.
Well, it's not easy, yeah. But that's a great candidate. You know what? It's so hard because inevitably for Coach of the Year, we pick the guy who exceeds expectations, right? And so that'd be Tubby Smith. Bill Self agrees with you. He said, man, have no further discussion. You look to Lubbock, and that is your Coach of the Year. Freshman of the Year was easy, Juwan Evans. But listen, Bob Huggins is in that conversation. Lon Kruger, with the player development, what he has done with no top 100 recruits. But for me, boy, it's Bill Self. Well, you sit down and you talk to Tubby Smith, and I'll flip it back on you. And Tubby sat there and told you and I the admiration and respect for what Bill Self has done, especially this year. Perhaps, and I don't mean this as critical as it sounds, the least talented starting five he's had in a long time. Three times during this streak, he has replaced all five starters. And yet here he is cutting down nets for the 12th consecutive year.
But essentially then you're giving him the Lifetime Achievement Award.
No, I'm not. They won the conference. They won the conference.
Page 4-3.
You can't penalize somebody because they're a great recruiter.
Well,
right?
It's not penalized.
So you recruit player development, and you manage a team and games. And it's hard to argue against Bill Self.
Tubby Smith is taking a program back to the tournament that hadn't been there for a long time. Since Bob Knight's final full season in Lubbock, he loses Norrence Odiasse in the stream of Big 12 play and gets them further along than they were when Odiasse was healthy.
Ask me who my runner-up was.
You are all over the silver medalists today. Who's your runner-up?
Tubby Smith.
Wow.
Okay. I struggled with that one.
Harmony falls upon us.
Hey, for about 3 weeks, Bob Huggins was my choice.
True.
You know, what they've done, picked sixth coming into this season, and what he's done without really a true superstar. Now, Jayshon Page, there were a pretty good argument that he's a superstar. But what he has done this year as far as exceeding expectation, man, he's in that conversation. And you just can't look past what Lon Kruger has done. There for a little while, Shaka Smart was in the conversation, too.
Certainly still could be. Daxter Miles with the miss and the rebound for Solomon. And that's not to say anything about what Steve Prohm has done in his first season. Scott Drew with Baylor, not terribly high expectations with that team. They've stayed afloat as well. Wow. West Virginia really collapses on the basketball. Carter loping through the lane, and he draws a whistle.
Well, Tavares Shine, Tavares Shine went baseline, and Mitchell Solomon was out here about 30 feet from the basket, and Tavares Shine was waiting for him to dive. Look out here to the left. Look how far out Solomon is, and you saw Shine turn and look for somebody diving to the basket, and that turnover was actually the fault of Mitchell Solomon not being where he needed to be.
You've talked about it a lot, the activity without the ball against the pressure for West Virginia. Carter makes it a 10-point game. Have you changed your coach of the year thought in the last
during this game?
2 minutes here.
I may change my vote. It's still, we still got 10 minutes to go.
It's getting late early. Carter looking at the multicolored orange student section. Out of bounds to Oklahoma State. So as exhibit A for Tubby Smith being coach of the year, here's the resume for Texas Tech with an RPI of 23. And we talked about it when we saw him in Waco, yeah, that they were starting to inch in, and they currently are in as an 8 seed for Joe Lunardi.
Well, they went on that stretch that was just remarkable, historic. And the number of ranked teams they beat in consecutive games. And Tubby Smith has done such a great job. You know who I'm really happy for?
Who's that?
There's a kid. There's kids for some reason you just kind of get attached to. Todrick Gocher. One of those kids that stuck through four coaches. He's with Bob Knight and Pat Knight and with Chris Walker and he's with Billy Gillespie. And man, just such a good kid working on his second Masters. And just for him, see that kid have success. Even today, he had 20 points in that loss at Kansas.
That one hit the shot clock. A couple extra passes for Oklahoma State. And Olivier will come back in.
Now, Oklahoma State staying with this 1-3-1. That's a nice adjustment by Travis Ford. And so far, now it's turned into a 1-2-2. Ooh, that's a travel.
Page. He's almost been better today when he's not had a clean look.
Yeah, he moved his pivot foot, caught that ball, and instead of 1 foot going, both feet went out as he started to move.
Well, Travis Ford, you're talking about coaches of the year. Travis Ford in his 8th season. Again, he's been to the tournament 5 of the last 7 years. It's certainly a down year, and as the conversation goes, he's not in the discussion for coach of the year, but you talk about 5 of 7 seasons in the tournament, and the feeling around here doesn't necessarily reflect that, it seems.
Very few teams can survive losing their 2 best players, especially on a team where the 2 best players are significantly, statistically better than everybody else.
Shine rimmed it out.
Oklahoma State with only 4 trips to the free throw line.
Page has been the focal point of the offense, trying to get rid of Griffin. Page battling for the rebound. And a tie-up goes to Oklahoma State.
That's the difficulty in a 2-3 zone. Because West Virginia rebounds at all 5 positions, the guys down on the front line are putting their bodies on someone, but the guards have to also. Look at the top of your screen. You see Page just come right down the middle, and Tyree Griffin never looked to box out. And when you're playing West Virginia, you got to box out all 5 guys when a shot goes up.
They are plus 13. The Mountaineers are rebounding wise this evening.
Well, 2nd in the country coming into tonight, offensive rebounding for Javon Carter and his teammates.
16 offensive rebounds a game for West Virginia.
And that's a big number.
They brought a little bit of the old Big East to the Big 12 on the glass. Hammonds left it short, and a foul on the rebound.
Yeah, Layden Hammonds went in anticipating getting hit, and he went in and thought he was going to get hit, so he hung onto the ball a little bit longer than he would have, and the contact never came.
Meantime, that's the fourth foul on Hammonds. Four against Burton, three against Shine, and Joe Burton comes back in for Hammonds, each with four personal fouls. What does Oklahoma State have to do to find some offense here in the final 8 minutes and change?
They're third in the Big 12 in free throw shooting. I think they need to get to the free throw line, quit settling for jump shots, and attack the basket a little bit more.
Yeah, one of seven in the second half from three-point range certainly doesn't help. One for two for Williams. Scooped up by Newberry to the rim, as you said, missed it. Daxter Miles has been quiet today, the sophomore, just 4 points total, none in the second half. Williams double teamed, taken away by Adrian, and he's fouled. It's on Shine, it's his fourth. Dire foul straights for Oklahoma State, trailing by 12. Oklahoma State's guards not boxing out, Reeve.
Yeah, look where Nate, look where Adrian is. He's at the top of the key all by himself, and the guards are all standing and looking at the basket and looking at the basketball. In defensive rebounding, when the ball goes up, you cannot follow the ball with your eyes. You've got to turn and find somebody, put your body on him, and then once you seal him, then find the ball and go rebound it. Travis Ford is frustrated about the call, but his team wouldn't be in that position if those guards would start boxing out there on the perimeter. That's twice in a row. We saw Jayshon Page get one, and then that time we saw Nathan Adrian come right down the middle to get the offensive rebound.
It's been a large cause of that foul trouble you saw. Oklahoma State has played only eight guys in this game more than 1 minute, and three of those eight have four personal fouls.
We talked about this in the first half, that Travis Ford was frustrated because he had a couple of guys pick up silly fouls they did not need to. Layden Hammonds picked one up that he didn't need to. Mitchell Solomon picked one up that he didn't need to. And so when you play a team and you don't have a lot of depth, boy, take the fouls you need to, but no mental errors. Oh, Travis is furious.
Third all-time winningest coach at Oklahoma State sees his team down 14. Well, good news for Oklahoma State is the turnovers have minimized significantly from the first half, just three after halftime.
13 at halftime and just three here in the second. Done a much better job handling the ball. That's the opposite of what we anticipated. We thought this pressure would wear on Oklahoma State and the turnovers would get worse.
Burton aggressively to the rim, and free throws coming. We remind you that tonight at 8:30, just up the road, ABC NBA Saturday primetime. Steph Curry and the Warriors, KD, Russell Westbrook, and OKC also streaming live on Watch ESPN and the ESPN app. The combined records of those two teams, 93-22. Should be a good one.
Yeah, that's going to be a good one. If you fall through and not getting us tickets, we need to go find a TV.
This now is pinned on my shoulders?
I'm fishing for anybody that can score us some tickets.
Two for two from the line. And a 12-point game as Page comes out.
Game's going to be at halftime by the time we can get there.
No problem.
Adrian steps into a three and got it. He thought he missed it. He was following his shot.
A 44% shooter from out there. Very effective. Does not shoot a lot of them, but boy, that's a weapon for West Virginia.
Foul on Miles, overplaying his hand defensively, his third.
Catches this ball in rhythm. Look at him, a trailer on the play. Steps into it, good balance, beautiful release. And following his shot, by the way.
Out of Morgantown High School, Had a nice game last year against Oklahoma State, 9 points, six rebounds.
Just recently named to the Academic All-Big 12 second team. Javon Carter was on the first team.
Adrian's one of those pieces. You know, you talk about 10 guys. Last nine games, he's 13 out of his last 20 from three-point range. It's a good weapon to have.
Well, that's going to be the secret to Oklahoma State getting back in this game. The last 6:58, Travis Ford's team, they have got to get to the free throw line.
7 out of 10 from there tonight. West Virginia has attempted 19 free throws. The large reason for Texas's win earlier, 27 free throws to 9 for Oklahoma. Tip ball, Carroll skies for it. Newberry. Adrian plucks the rebound. Carter in a hurry, got the contact.
Well, Carter got that ball. There are three Cowboys down at the paint, and nobody picked him up till he got past the Roman numerals on the floor. You've got to come out. He picked up so much speed from half court, and look how many white shirts are back. There's one, two, three, and nobody ever steps out in front of him. In fact, they didn't ever step in front of him. It wasn't at the Roman numerals. They never got in front of him in the basket.
Carter, the free throw. We mentioned in the first half, West Virginia, 288th in the country in free throw percentage, but tremendous tonight, 17 out of 20, 85%.
They're so methodical. You know, West Virginia is one of these teams that if they play, you know, it's silly to say, if anyone plays well, they're going to blow you out. But they can get away from you and not really play particularly great basketball. They're just, the pressure is so relentless that, boy, all of a sudden you look up and what was a close game is 15 points. And you know, Bob Huggins' team, very methodical in the way they continue to attack.
That play was a perfect example. Even though Carter picked up the foul, he saw the ball slip away for half a second. It was just salivating to go after it. So Jeff Newberry to the free throw line. Held scoreless in the second half until that free throw.
And a great free throw shooter, 82% for the season. The last four games, Jeff Newberry has averaged 16 points per game.
Former JUCO All-American, New Mexico Junior College by way of Northeastern Oklahoma A&M. After a redshirt year at Ole Miss in 2012.
Listen, as much as Oklahoma State has struggled on the offensive end, they're ninth in scoring. They've been really good defensively in Big 12 games. They're third in the conference in scoring defense, third in defensive field goal percentage. And Jeff Newberry is first in the conference in conference games in steals.
Yeah, he's got a foul that time. Third against Newberry. Double bonus the rest of the way with 6:06 to play on both sides, 10 fouls plus. You like free throws, Reed?
Yes, I do, as a matter of fact.
West Virginia provides many of those.
It's the only time on a basketball court I ever found myself open.
Your modesty is overwhelming. Second for Tariq Phillip. Wouldn't fall. You're telling me with all those guys around you, Drexler and Olajuwon, they never left you open?
No.
I think they play in the paint. Double off of you. You were a weapon.
The best post defense you can play is pressuring the passer. And, you know, if you let a passer stand out there, and especially I had the advantage of being 6'7", throwing to a 7-footer. And so I've rarely found myself standing out there without somebody harassing me. Also, let's face it, you just see me on the court, you think, I can take the ball from you.
I know the feeling. down low. Two more free throws coming for the Mountaineers.
Who do you think is their toughest matchup in an NCAA tournament situation? What type of team would give West Virginia the most trouble?
It's a good question. You know, you obviously, if you're going to beat West Virginia, you got to have really good guard play. But I also think a big guy that can finish. And so when you break pressure, I'm a big proponent of, even if you don't want to play fast, you can't let a team press you for free. So you can't let them press you, break the press, and then set it up. You have to punish somebody, so you've got to take it all the way through. In the first half, Oklahoma State was successful taking it through and shooting threes, 6 for 10. But to me, when you break a press, you got numbers. You got 2-on-1, 3-on-2. And so if you've got big athletic guys that, you know, you got guards that can shoot floaters or big guys that you can toss it up to the rim, I think that's kind of the skill set that would give West Virginia the most difficulty.
Carroll draws a foul, and he'll get two shots. Foul on Elijah Macon. We mentioned Carroll earlier in the game. Hadn't practiced in a week, has an odd stomach bug that's gone without formal diagnosis the last 3 weeks.
Didn't know if he'd play until this morning. Woke up and showed up and said, hey, I feel pretty good. He was excellent. He's had two career double-doubles, and one of them was in the first meeting in Morgantown. Had 10 points, 11 rebounds in that game. Was good against Iowa State the other night at home. Had 18 points, a career high, 4-7 behind the three-point line. 7 rebounds in that game.
Looks like the type of guy that could fill out into that body too, right? Sophomore?
Yeah.
Tariq Phillip up ahead to Myers, and you see the depth of West Virginia. Deshaun Page off the floor, and a takeaway for the Cowboys. Griffin threw it away.
The drought has been lengthy for Oklahoma State. Last field goal for Travis Ford's team came at the 11:35 mark, nearly 7 minutes ago.
Oh, my.
Newberry to check back in. Carroll out. As you talked about, West Virginia in the second half, late in games, you have 10 versus somebody else's 5 or 6. And a foul called against Oklahoma State. It's on Newberry. It's his fourth. Well, Travis Ford has 4 guys with 4 personal fouls. At this point, Shine, Burton, Newberry, and Hammonds.
That game the other night against Iowa State, in which Jayshon Page broke the West Virginia record for a non-starter with 34 points. Tariq Phillip also came off the bench in that game and had a career night, 6 of 8 behind the three-point line, chipped in another 22. So how's that for bench production? You're talking about 56 points from 2 players off the bench.
Foul down low against Macon. And you talk about the three-point shooting ability of Phillip. He started the season 0 for 12 from 3. Made 30 of his next 59 coming into this game as Macon called for the foul. Sophomore who started a game last year, played in 33 for Bob Huggins. This is the 42nd free throw combined tonight.
Tyree Griffin has been really good. You know, he lost Phil Forte. He lost Juwan Evans. And, well, the last 3 games, he's had a terrific assist-to-turnover ratio. He's 4th in the Big 12 in assists behind Lester Metro, Monte Morris, and Isaiah Taylor at UT. And so a really solid season for Tyree Griffin.
It was interesting talking to Travis Ford before the game. He said Griffin's come to him with that bum ankle at points and said, can I get a break? And coach says, sorry, buddy.
Sure.
We got to have you.
In the middle of April.
Out of bounds, tipped by Oklahoma State.
You know, there's a lot of kids that wouldn't buy into that. There's some kids that get hurt and say, you know what, I'm going to just check in for the season and I'll come back next year. And
even when they rehab and have an opportunity to get back on the floor, not always do guys want to come back.
Especially in a tough season when things aren't going your way. You lose 6 out of 7.
You know, you come in with expectations, and the season's not meeting your expectations, and sometimes it's hard to play through injuries and pain and bumps and bruises.
Yet I've made it an entire Big 12 year with you.
It's not over yet, partner.
Foul call to the sideline. It goes against Griffin. That's his third. I am pretty soon with this foul trouble. They're going to have to call the Graham brothers. Have to call Marcus Smart, see if he's available. You have four guys with four fouls, one with three.
Keaton Page is over there on the bench.
Tavon Myers, his first season in the program for West Virginia. We were talking about it actually last week in Ames about how difficult it is to succeed consistently with transfers coming into the program because of the revolving door, and Bob Huggins has turned that into a science. Not that he's got 6 or 7 guys, but he's got a couple and he integrates them very well.
Yeah, it's a great point, Jason, because the expectations have changed because there's some coaches and some programs recently have had a significant amount of success with transfers. Suddenly you think, oh, transfers, that's a good thing, and you're always successful when guys come in. Well, the reason that was a big deal is because that was a big deal. That's unusual, and that's unique, and more often than not, well, that is not a formula for success, accepting a bunch of transfers.
First field goal in over 7 minutes for Oklahoma State is a Leighton Hammonds three. The lead is a dozen against Travis Ford's team. West Virginia trying to escape with Big 12 win number.
These guys cannot beat us. Well, they can. And get a good look at Coach Sutton. Eddie Sutton leaving the game. It's good to see Coach Sutton. Yeah. For crying out loud, put that man in the Hall of Fame. I mean, my gosh, what does it take? I got so bent out of shape over Guy Lewis, and they finally put him in before he passed away earlier this year. And boy, if anybody out there that is worthy and have credentials and Hall of Fame worthy, it's Eddie Sutton. And for the life of me, I can't fathom why the voters continue to leave him out.
Well, I certainly know in Stillwater what he's meant to the game of basketball, as you see the signature on the court. At Gallagher-Iba Arena, Eddie Sutton Court.
Doug Gottlieb wrote a very passionate letter, kind of an open letter to the media that I thought was very well done. And I understand those frustrations. You know, Guy Lewis for years was ignored and wasn't voted in and got close. And as former players, you have so much personal investment that you feel like you've got to stand up and fight for guys like that. And then you really step back and go, crying out loud, Eddie Sutton doesn't need us fighting for him. But man, it's just hard to understand, you know, whether it's a bias or what the justification is. But that's something that's really stuck in my craw for a while, and it has been an honor long, long overdue.
Well, you mentioned your coach going in. What did that mean to Guy Lewis?
You know, it's interesting. I think it meant more to us than it did him. The basketball, College Basketball Hall of Fame in Kansas City inducted him years ago. And so I think for the rest of us, it meant more than it did him. But I was so glad they did it before he passed away. He passed away on Thanksgiving this year and was inducted over the summer. And so that was, you know, a man that needed and had deserved and earned that honor. And I feel the same way about Eddie Sutton. You know, I've seen Eddie Sutton. I played against his teams. I coached against his teams. I've announced his teams for years and years and watched him. And the success and the impact that he's had on the game and on young men's lives, it is a Hall of Fame career.
And if you're interested in the names we're talking about, and you do go to the Big 12 championship in Kansas City,
it's a cool display.
Yep.
In the spring. If you haven't been there, you need to go to that thing because it is really cool.
College basketball experience. 12-point game ticking down to 3 minutes. We'll see how Oklahoma State plays it. Not a whole lot of fouls to give in terms of staying in the game. Four Cowboy players with four personal fouls. Carter diving, left it short. And a foul on the rebound. It's going to stay with West Virginia. Big Monday presented by Delta in the ACC. 7 Eastern, Syracuse against North Carolina, number 7 in the country, in Chapel Hill. Then in the Big 12, in Austin at 9 Eastern. That's on ESPN. Both games streaming live on Watch ESPN and the ESPN app as Leighton Hammonds has fouled out for Oklahoma State. That's a big game for Texas in terms of seeding and helping itself in the NCAA tournament.
But it's going to be an atmosphere almost identical to what you saw at the Irwin Center today for Oklahoma. It was sold out. It was loud. Those are the kind of crowds that Shaka Smart wants to have every game, and not just when OU and not just when Kansas come in. And so on one hand, you'd look at it and go, oh, Kansas has won it. There's not really anything to play for. Nobody else is going to win the conference and catch them. But you know what? That is going to be a great atmosphere. And if you love college basketball, man, that's going to – I'm looking forward to that game very much.
Not that Shaka Smart would be number one on the list for Coach of the Year, but you lose Cam Ridley at the beginning of the Big 12 season and still turn out the team that he has. You've got to be impressed with what's going on at Austin.
I agree with that, and I think you framed it exactly right. The success they had didn't surprise me because there's a lot of talent there, but the fact that they lost Cameron Ridley completely retooled, kind of similar to what Travis Ford was telling us he's had to do, but what he's done without Cameron Ridley, who was playing the best of basketball of his career at the time, remarkable. Shaka Smart is everything that we thought he was going to be. He has been in Austin in his first season.
Miles leans in, got into Solomon, and Oklahoma State pushes. 10-point game, more than 2 minutes left. Griffin to Solomon for three.
Good hustle.
And out of bounds to Oklahoma State.
Yeah, very nice hustle that time. Tyree Griffin goes into the corner, I think throws it off of Jayshon Page's head as they're going out of bounds. Yeah, no, just topped it off his shoulder. Nice hustle play.
Tyree Griffin with all of his points in the second half, all 7. 5 of them coming from the free throw line. The sophomore out of New Orleans and Landry Walker High School. Newberry draws the foul. 2 free throws coming. 2:01 to play. It's the 4th on Page.
This might have been a different game had Oklahoma State started playing this way, maybe coming right out of the locker room. And you can't be critical of the way they played in the first half. They made 6 out of 10 three-point field goals. But if they'd attacked the basket sooner and gotten to the free throw line sooner, you know, this might be a totally different score that we're looking at. And they're still not out of it, but well, they've done such a nice job of getting to the free throw line here the last 8 minutes of this game.
We'll remind our viewers that if you're tuning in for Baylor TCU, that game's live now on ESPN News, and we'll follow immediately our game with 120 seconds to go. Do you foul now or don't you?
Yeah, I'd foul and go ahead and take a couple of shots. Whoa, there's an offensive foul. I mean, you're down 3 shots, right? 3 possessions, and you're back in this thing, and I absolutely keep playing.
48 combined personal fouls. That offensive foul against Phillip is his 4th personal. Burton got his feet set and left it short.
Oh boy, they got a good trap, and Tavares Shine was so late on that. Well, they got a great trap, got a bounce pass down the midcourt stripe, and kept waiting for Tavares Shine to get there. And watch it, passes exactly the way you want to set this up, and especially with a bounce pass. You don't ever want to throw the ball down the line, but you sure don't want to bounce it. That's the slowest pass in basketball. A missed opportunity by Tavares Shine to run through that pass.
Reed, that's 5 against Shine. He's finished. So Hammonds and Shine have fouled out. Burton and Newberry each have 4 personals as well. And Carroll who's been varying degrees of ill the past 3 weeks with a stomach bug, has come back in. Well, West Virginia will foul you out, won't they?
Yeah, they will.
And we talked about this in the first half. There were a couple of fouls that Tavares Schein and a couple of his teammates took that we said that wasn't needed. And when you don't have a lot of depth, you don't take cheap fouls. And they were in a 2-3 zone, and a couple of were on the perimeter. And we speculated that it may catch up to them, and it certainly has here at the end of the game.
Phillip 1-for-2, back to 10. Bob Huggins tries to secure win number 22. Baylor TCU coming your way next. And a throwaway taken by Devin Williams. Looks like Oklahoma State is going back off with a 1:18 to play. Page found his way to the rim, and it's stuck. Tie-up goes to West Virginia. Well, Bob Huggins' team has gone 25 out of 35 from the free throw line. Oklahoma State 14 of 20. And a foul called against Solomon. That's his third. I asked you earlier, Reed, do you like free throws?
What was my answer?
Your answer was yes at that juncture.
I'm
you're wobbling like Coach of the Year?
I'm losing that loving feeling a little bit.
Williams, the most frequent free throw shooter for West Virginia. We joke, but that's a big part of West Virginia's game. Fourth most free throws attempted in the country. And if they're going to go far in the tournament, you'd imagine the Mountaineers would have to shoot well from the free throw line.
Ninth. They only shoot 66% in conference games. That's ninth in the Big 12. And you're exactly right. They are going to get to the free throw line every game. I don't care who they're playing against. And a lot of their success in March may end up being ability to knock down those free throws.
They open play today, according to Joe Lunardi, as a 3 seed as Carroll misses. West Virginia, remember, with a double-figure win against Kansas earlier this year at home. That will certainly help for seeding purposes.
You know, a very business-like game for West Virginia. They didn't get too high. They didn't get too low. Boy, they came in and just played their relentless brand of basketball and have just attacked the entire game.
Relentless and attacking. Daxter Miles, the follow slam. Griffin lost it out of bounds. Well, for Travis Ford's team, a loss, number 13 in Big 12 play. They led this game 24-16, but West Virginia was too much.
Any win on the road is a good win in the Big 12. So this is a game that if West Virginia didn't come in, they didn't play their style, didn't play hard, they could have lost this game. Bob Huggins' team had a good showing here this afternoon in Stillwater, Oklahoma.
Long conversation between the two head coaches, and our final score goes West Virginia's way, 70-56. For Reed Geddes, Jason Benetti, our entire crew, coming up next, Big 12 basketball continues. Baylor TCU, we say goodnight from Gallagher-Iba Arena in Stillwater. Now to Fort Worth.